When all has gone quiet and the world begins to sleep, cooed in and snug beneath a blanket of frost, when the universe holds its breath and angels begin to stretch their wings and stars begin to slide into constellations of hope, when music seems to hang in the air and creation hums its own carol about the longing for light and birth again from wintertime, then the waiting ones gather to listen to these rumors and whisper about the birth of a child made all of light. And together, pass the word that very soon and very soon Advent will slip into sign and waiting into birth. So let us gather with ever-beating hearts, staying with Mary and Joseph, wondering, laboring, longing, expecting the promise to break through the night. Please stand and sing, O Come, All Ye Faithful. Tomorrow morning, unless you come to my house in your pajamas. exam is, and if that's the case, you're getting cereal. Just so you know. We are so honored to be gathered tonight with you. I want to thank a few people beforehand. There's not announcements at the end, so I have a couple instructions and a couple thank yous. First of all, thank you to Danita and to Stan for helping plan this service, for accompanying us, for over the past few weeks going above and beyond. You guys filled in when we were really begging God for help, and you answered God's call, so thank you so much. Char, as usual, you're sort of my sidekick now, whether you like it or not, you're stuck with me. Thank you for pulling together an even bigger choir than we expected and whipping these people into shape. You are the best. Thank you. I think she's smiling behind her mask, but I can't tell. We have a bunch of sound people and video people that are with us also. And the reason that I want to say a special thank you to all of these people is because it's Christmas. And so they're giving up their time with their family to be with us and to help us worship the newborn king, or soon-to-be newborn king. It's hard, isn't it? Because December 25th used to be Christmas. But now Jesus has taken over December 24th as well. And Christmas starts on the 24th, and it goes into the 25th, sometimes even into New Year's or beyond. So there's just no end to what this guy will take. I mean, it's everything with him. Also, thank you to my husband and my family for all that they did today to help get this service ready. Our little granddaughter, Emma, was... Emma's the little redhead up here. Well, she's not so little anymore, but... Emma helped decorate the altar area, and I think she did a great job. She had a little bit of help. Now for some quick instructions. Communion at Salem is open, and everybody is welcome, regardless of church membership or what you understand about communion or don't understand about communion, your age, anything you can think of whatsoever. You are welcome at the table because it's not our table and it's not our rules. It's God's. Christ is the host and Christ invites you. So please come when communion is served. You will receive a piece of bread. If you want gluten-free, please just say to either I or the other bread server that you would like the gluten-free option, and we will serve you gluten-free option. Wine, you will choose your own glass of wine. It's red juice is wine, and the clear juice is grape juice. And then there's baskets on either side of the sanctuary to put the cups in when you are done. The other thing is a safety thing. So we're going to light some candles and have the beautiful silent night candlelight that we have come to know and love on Christmas Eve. So when we do so, as you light your candle from another candle, always, always, always tip the candle that is not lit. Don't tip the candle that is lit because you can, obviously hot wax can get on you or the person next to you, and we do not want any injuries. So I think that's all of the instructions. Okay. Then I have to remember what comes next. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who sends the word with angels, who is made flesh among all people, and who breathes peace on all the earth. Amen. Let us pray. So this would be a great time for anyone who feels so moved to come and light all the candles on the Advent wreath as well as the candles on the altar, because our regular candle lighter is not able to be with us tonight, and when that happens, we forget. Almighty God, we thank you for the birth of the Christ child in Bethlehem. As announced by the angels on this holy night, may the mystery of the Word made flesh fill our souls with wonder and yearning. Change our hearts from a busy inn to a quiet chamber for your glory. May we who are gathered here join in song with the angels, share the delight of the shepherds, and adore him with the wise men. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. In Christ, we are bold to name our sin and cry out for peace in ourselves, with God and one another. Holy God, we confess our sin before you. We replace compassion with competition. We seek what is mighty while ignoring the meek. We are quick to anger but slow to forgive. We have not put on love in harmony with you. Wrap us in the grace of your powerful word. Swaddle our hearts with your peace, that all we do in word or deed may reflect your love born among us. Amen. I bring you great news of... If there was a redo button, we would hit it right now and start this over, but there's not, so... I bring you good news of great joy for all people. God has come among us in the child born of Mary, Christ the Lord. In Christ, your sins are forgiven and you are clothed in peace. Amen.
Thank you. first reading is from Isaiah chapter 9. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who have lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as people exult when dividing plunder. For the yoke of their burden and the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian. For all the boots of the tramping warriors and all the garments rolled in blood shall be burned as fuel for the fire. For a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time onward and forevermore. Yes, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. Here ends our first reading. The second reading is from the Gospel of John, chapter 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. Here ends our second reading.
If there are any children that would like to come sit with me for a moment, I would love that. Yes, it's a bribe. You sit right in front of me. Can you sit right in front of me? Can you guys sit in front of me so I can see you? I know they want to see you because you're much cuter than I am, but. Hello, come on in. How are you guys?
Good.
Are you excited about tonight? Why? Because God was born. You are so good. I mean, like, that's it. That's the sermon. That's it in a nutshell. So, Grayson, why are you excited about tonight? Because what's happening? Because God was, I don't know. Yep, we're in church, so nobody's going to answer. Adults, why might you be excited about tonight? Anybody? Yeah? Because Jesus is born. Okay, so we're going to go at this from another angle. Do you guys have Christmas trees at your house? Yes, what's under the Christmas tree? Presents, that's right. They're gifts, right? Are any of the gifts to you?
Yes.
No. Are they really? They have your name on it? Ooh, can I tell you where that tradition came from? Although you already answered it, but I'm going to tell you anyway because the people out there, you know, all the big people out there, they might not know. So this whole idea about gifts started when Jesus was born. It's the idea that God gave us the greatest gift of all by giving us his son. Not just anyone, God's very son, his only son. God in the flesh. So when you think about God, it's hard to imagine what God might look like, right? Because there's not really form or a person or a picture. God's more like energy, and you can't see energy, right? But you can see a light bulb. So God's more like energy or spirit, and you can't see spirit, but you might feel the spirit like you would feel the wind. You can't see the wind either. So God put flesh on and was born a baby. That's right. When it's cold and you blow your breath out, you can see your breath. That's absolutely right. So God put flesh on so that we could see God. And that was the greatest gift to humankind ever. And so when we think about the gifts under our tree, they're really cool and they're fun and they're exciting, and I, for one, can't wait to open them in the morning. But we also think about that gift started, the idea of those gifts under the tree, started with the night that Jesus was born, and God gave God's very Son to the world so that our sin, the things that we do wrong, the things that we do bad, the things we regret or the mistakes that we make would be forgiven, but most importantly, that we would know what it means to be human. Right? That's pretty big, isn't it? Like, I know how to be a girl, kind of. And I know how to be a mom, sort of, and I'm fairly good at being a nana. I'm somewhat good at being a pastor. But what does it mean to be human? What does it mean to be a human? That's big, right? The story that we read in the Bible about Jesus tells us everything that we need to know about being a human being. And Jesus summed it up in two sentences. Love God with all your heart and with all your mind and with all your soul, and love your neighbor the way that you want to be loved. That's what it means to be human. That's pretty cool, isn't it? Now you know the purpose of life, and you can go out and tell everybody it's not about working a job necessarily, it's not about a career necessarily, it's not about all these wonderful things that you have or the number of presents under your tree, but it's about love. I'm going to give you two candy canes, and this is the reason why. One of them is shaped like a J, reminds you of Jesus. The other one is shaped like a shepherd's staff, and it reminds you that God is always with you to protect you just like a shepherd. But when you put the two together, what do you get?
Heart.
A heart. And a heart reminds you of love. That's right. And that's what the gifts under your tree are about, and the gift that God gave us in Jesus is all about. That's it. Here you go. You can go back and make hearts and spell out Jesus with a J. Here you go. Thanks for coming up and talking with me. It means a lot. It makes me happy to see you. You're welcome. Are there any other kids out there that didn't quite have the courage? It's hard. Standing in front of people is like the hardest thing in the world. It really is, trust me. Anybody else that didn't come up? You're not a kid, but you look kind of young enough to like candy canes still. I know all the choir wants them, but they're not good. I have a little nugget of information for you to start off. The word Christmas, it actually comes from two words. The first being Christ, which obviously refers to Jesus and especially Jesus' birth. The second word, mass, is a Middle English word from a Latin word meaning to dismiss or to send. When we say Merry Christmas or Merry Christ Mass, we may actually be saying something like, go on your merry way, sent in Christ to live the Christ Mass story. Which is one of the most difficult things for pastors on days such as these to do. Find creative and inspiring words, like a pep rally of sorts, to help us get excited about changing old behaviors that hurt ourselves or others, changing attitudes like resentment, vengeance, etc., which are actually poisons we drink ourselves, expecting our enemies to die. Resignations that tell us, yes, Jesus loves me, the Bible tells me so, but I don't really need to continue Bible study or growing in my relationship with God or my church family. I've got this. Or what we may soon be about to do, shutting out what comes next, tuning out of the telling of the all-too-familiar Christ Mass story, and pondering the numerous things we still need to do to get ready for Christmas, get ready for Christ Mass. We need to wrap a few more presents, make our famous mashed potatoes, oh shoot, add to the list, pick up potatoes, hang the stockings, put the ham in the oven, pick up a little more wine or grape juice, write those last few Christmas cards, and this year, get tested for COVID before your gathering or guests arrive. So now that we've gone through the list, here's the good news. For the next little while, you can't do any of it, none of it, until you walk to your vehicle and head out of the parking lot. Running your mind through the to-do list marathon won't do a single solitary thing except distract you from the most miraculous event in the history of time, since, well, in the beginning, honestly. So shut it all down for a sec. Take a deep breath. I mean, literally, take a deep breath. Relax your shoulders. Unclench your jaw. You'd be amazed at how often when we think about that, we're actually doing it. Smooth out your forehead. It causes wrinkles. It's just not pretty. And most important of all, soften the walls of your heart and imagine. Imagine that on a night such as tonight, God would put on flesh and be born human. Now, this should give us pause. And if it doesn't, then we need to simply ponder God with a capital G. Because how do we think about God? Maybe that's the problem. Why God putting on flesh to not just be with us, but be one of us, has lost its punch. Maybe we've diluted God down to bumper sticker theology type sayings and understandings and forgotten to look up. And I do mean literally up. Look up at the night sky full of darkness, yet filled with billions of trillions of stars and trillions of galaxies. And then, look down at your toes. Remember, you're supposed to be imagining. Humbling, isn't it? Yet it is for you that the architect of all we know put on skin and wiggled his toes when his mother tickled him. It is for love, love for you and for all of humankind. Undiluted God in the flesh is the very definition of love. Love with us. Love with us not to help God understand what it means to be human, but to help us understand more fully who God is and God's love for us, for humankind. And as I said to the children, what it means to be human, to be mirrors of God's love and mercy and grace. Mirrors. To first see ourselves, to see ourselves in God's love as infinitely valuable, unconditionally loved, and freed from sin, death, and evil. Then to see so as we look behind us in the mirror to our families, communities, even our enemies, the world, and in the not-so-distant future, the universe and its trillions of galaxies and all that we may find. Now, I imagine you're almost back to your to-do list, so bear with me just one more sec and imagine again. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. We are talking about Jesus here. Jesus being not just our brother, but also God with a capital G. Whenever time began, Jesus was before even then. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him, not one thing came into being. In other words, Jesus was and is co-creator with Father, Mother, God. Jesus doesn't just walk on water, but made water. What has come into being in him was life. And the life was the light of all people. This light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not and cannot overcome it. Life came into being through Jesus. Life, not just the beating of a heart or the green grass that shoots through the snow in spring, but life that is the light of all people. Imagine life. The light of all people is hope. Hope is Jesus. A friend once told me, it wasn't my job to inspire or give hope to people. That was disappointing because it sort of like comes along with the job description, right, as a pastor? But my friend said it wasn't my job to inspire or give hope to people. It was my job to point to the one who is our hope, Jesus. Which is actually a huge relief, because the other is an impossible job and one destined to fail. Just as we are mirrors through which we see and reflect God's love, hope does not lie within us, but always comes from the one who is the light of the world, Jesus. And this light is life. Life for those living in fear of when the next bomb will drop, gun will go off, or hurricane will hit. Life for those living in fear of being abused, manipulated, bullied, or harassed again and again. Life for those who will go hungry tonight and tomorrow. Life for those who shiver in the cold. Life for those who wish for a cure. Life for those who are just tired. Tired of working and coming home too exhausted for anything more. Tired of the world fighting over things that simply don't matter. Tired of being judged, condemned, and sentenced as bad or not enough, with no hope for redemption. those who have messed up with no way of making it right. Know that God is with us, our light, hope, and life. Know that you matter. You are not alone. You are not forgotten. You are appreciated. May I say that again? You are appreciated. You are seen. You are heard. You are forgiven. You are loved. God is with you, each of us, and every human being carries a spark of God's life and light. As through Jesus, life and light were created, Jesus continues to enlighten and enliven you, us, and all people. God's very presence attends our every breath. God's love attends our every heart's beat. God's grace attends our every action. And God's mercy attends our every need. Imagine with me one more time. Imagine a place, a people, a community built on the birth of Jesus. God with us. Imagine not a world, that may be a bit much, but a relationship built on the birth of the source of love itself. Relationships of genuine concern, compassion, and care for one another. Relationships that honor and cherish the God spark, even and especially when it's covered over with hurts, fears, and shame. How might we treat one another differently? How might we envision the church, our ministry within these walls, and most importantly, outside these walls? How might we make this Christmas, this marking of God with us, different? How might we make this story come alive with life and light, hope and promise and possibility? How might we listen anew, not with our ears, but with our hearts open and eager and expectant, like that of a mother about to give birth? How might we tell the story of Christmas in new and inspiring ways, ways that reflect and proclaim God's love for humankind and the whole world, not just with our mouth, but with our actions and attitudes as well? How might we carry Christmas past the wrapping paper, gifts under the tree, gatherings of families and friends, and especially this worship service? How do we not just do Christ Mass, but live Christ Mass? Please stand for the reading of the Gospel. In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child. And she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger because there was no place for them in the inn. Please join with me singing verses 1 and 3 of Away in a Manger, hymn number 277. in that region there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you great news, good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favors. Let the angels gathered around me sing together, Angels We Have Heard on High," number 289, verses 1 and 2. Worshiping in various places and ways and understandings, but united in love of your Son, Jesus. Grant us vision to see beyond our fears and frustrations to your purpose for us together in our community and world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Thank you, God, for creation and creatures great and small. Saturate our hearts with desire to care for land and sky, waters, and especially animals endangered by our carelessness and greed. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Thank you, God, for the nations and leaders of nations. We pray for peace, the well-being of all peoples, and abundant life in all places. Change our hearts and help us grow up and shed the bonds of racism, sexism, judgment based on a person's religion, ability, sexual orientation, economic status, age, weight, or any other way we look on the outside. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Thank you, God, for protectors. We pray especially for the men and women who serve in the armed forces, those who work in law enforcement or our judicial system, firefighters, EMTs, first responders, dispatchers, and advocates for the least. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Thank you, God, for doctors, nurses, and medical staff, for medicines and medical procedures, and access to health care and insurance. Strengthen and give hope to all in need of healing, especially Reese Erickson, Steve Antonson, Lois Allen, Noel Mills, Sharon Smitten, Brenda Mullenmaster, Arlen Shires, Lonnie Gaffey, Darren, those who live with addiction, chronic pain or disease, those on our prayer chain, those with COVID-19, and those we name out loud or in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Thank you, God, for family, friends, and neighbors. We pray for those who are alone, feel alienated or excluded from loved ones and gatherings this Christmas. We pray for men, women, and children in abusive situations, for those who struggle to make ends meet, are without jobs or adequate wages, for those who are food insecure or lack needed medicines and medical care, and for anyone who finds themselves without a place to call home. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And thank you, God, for those who have loved us and whom we have been loved by, but are celebrating Christmas in heaven this year. The pain and emptiness of grief is proportional to love shared, and yet, as much as we hurt, it's worth a million times over. Grant strength to all who grieve, and courage to grieve as we need. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Rejoicing in your word made flesh among us, we commend these prayers to you, confident of your grace and love made known to us in Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. We are so grateful for the offerings that you placed in the gift bags as you came in on the ushers' tables, or whether electronically or through our website. People have been so generous this year, and we are sincerely thankful. But with those gifts, we also give thanks to God. So please join me in the offering prayer printed in your bulletin. With these gifts, dear God, accept the praise and thanksgiving of our hearts, which rejoice in your goodness and love. Let our gifts point to your presence in the world and further your dream for the world, through Jesus Emmanuel, God with us. Amen. The Lord is with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. We give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and Merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. In the wonder and mystery of the Word made flesh, you have opened the eyes of faith to a new and radiant vision of your glory, that beholding the God made visible, we may be drawn to love the God whom we cannot see. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this." this for the remembrance of me. Remembering, therefore, his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all who share this heavenly food, the body and blood of Jesus Christ, our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory now and forever. Amen. Let us pray together the prayer our Savior taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. All is ready and all are welcome. Let us sing together, I am so glad each Christmas Eve as we come with joy to the Lord's table. Thank you. God bless and unite us with Christ and all who share this heavenly feast, sending us out to be his presence in and for the world. Amen.
Thank you.
go to be the gift another needs, sharing God's blessings of love and grace, running to tell the story we heard from the shepherds. Let us go to be the comfort which swaddles others, sharing Jesus' compassion with those in need, welcoming the holiness offered by the most vulnerable we meet. Let us go to kindle the lives around us, sharing the Spirit's presence with all the broken, learning the language of hope from the children in our midst. Before we sing our sending hymn, Hark the Herald Angels Sing, I want to also thank our trumpeter tonight, Tom Olmsted. He adds a beautiful part to our worship service and made tonight most joyous. So, Tom and Danita, take it away. Maybe a few things could have gotten better. But let